Hello. Okay, so thank you so much for coming in the TENET class. Very dry class.
Thank you so much for doing the class.
So maybe Gugi, you come here, you don't need to land on that wall.
Yeah, because of the wall.
Anyway, so thank you so much for coming to the TENET class. I know everybody knows it is a very important class, very important topics. So I think most of you realized when you listen teaching from any other master, there's a big difference between before you study TENET, after you study TENET. Because TENET is very important. So many people happy to study Namrim. When they reach to the wisdom chapter, most people, you know, give up. Because wisdom chapter is mentioned a lot about emptiness. It talk about a lot of negation, how to negate things. Special, the most of the wisdom chapter talk about the Madhyamaka point of view, special consequence. Shall point of view, so the TENET is very important. So there's a four schools, you know, four TENETs. Then there are four proponents, four schools has four proponents. That's why what Buddha said in his teaching, there are only four schools, not fifth school, only four schools. In his teaching, there are only three yan or three paths, which is hearer, solitary razor, and Buddhisattva's yan. Only three yan or three paths, only four school, four tenets. Why there are only, you know, three paths? Why there are only four school, not fifth, no fourth yan? Because based on the fourth Buddha, Buddha Shakyamuni, he gave a teaching according to the disciples. At that time, there were the three types of disciples who wish to achieve Nirvana. So Nirvana has a two meaning, right? One is the complete Nirvana. One is non-complete Nirvana. Someone just wish to be achieve Nirvana. They wish to be free from suffering, free from samsara. They don't want to be, you know, Buddha. They don't want to be, you know, master to teach others. That's why there are only three yan or three paths. One just want to practice only themselves, only alone. They be called solitary realizer. A hearer, they want to practice the path only achieving Nirvana only for themselves, but they still want to, you know, attend, want to listening the Mahayana teaching. You go hearer. They just hear, listen, they don't want to practice. The solitary realizer, they don't want to hear the Mahayana teaching, they don't want to practice, even they don't want to hear, that's for the solitary realizer. Then the, you know, Mahayana or Bodhisattva. Then someone is more brave, they thought, oh, I have a connection with all sentient beings. If I be, you know, free from samsara, myself is not really fair to all other sentient beings are in samsara. They are facing problems. They have a lot of suffering. I want to be Buddha in order to release all sentient beings from samsara. So we are considered you know, follow of Mahayana teaching, we are considered practitioner of Mahayana. So each time when we practice, each time we do some good thing, we should not forget to cultivate, you know, the great motivation, which is great compassion, which is bodhicitta. If you think, you know, all sentient beings want to be free from suffering, if you wish all sentient beings be happy, then your suffering you can see very small, very minor, not important. Also, if you think all sentient beings wish to be happy, then you think your happiness is nothing. Then you don't have a sense of strong desire about your own happiness. If you wish, if you have a strong wishing to be Buddha, benefit all sentient beings, then automatically, you know, your happiness will come along with the, you know, wishing for all sentient beings. That's why we have only three vehicles. Then we have only four schools, four tenets. Because at the Buddha lifetime, Buddha gave how many different types of teaching? Only three, right? You know, first will of Dharma, the second will of Dharma, third will of Dharma. So for you, it's simple to know, first will of Dharma means, okay, from here to here, he give first will of Dharma. From here to there, second. There to there, third. It's not like this. The three will of Dharma is differentiated based on the contents, based on the, you know, subject. Even though the first teaching he talked about Four Noble Truths, similar with the topic, even though before he passed away, he talked about Four Noble Truths, all this teaching include into first will of Dharma. Not necessarily the teaching have to be given by Buddha before the second will of Dharma. A similar topic, similar object. The second, you know, is totally different. He talked about every phenomena, you know, totally empty of inherent emptiness, empty of inherent existence. Then, the similar meaning, even though before he passed away, he talked about emptiness. This teaching was included into second will of Dharma. And third, you know, the great differentiation teaching, differentiation between the three natures. That's why the people who only follow, you know, the first will of Dharma. Based on the first will of Dharma, what Buddha said, things are exist inherently. So the people who follow this kind of concept, they will call, you know, the first two schools. The second, he talked about emptiness. You know, the proponent, the person, the disciple who follow the second will of Dharma and claim things are not exist independently. Things are totally empty of inherent existence. Then the people we call the follower of the, you know, Madhyamaka school. The person is, you know, Madhyamaka, like a proponent of Madhyamaka school. And third time, you know, the first he said things are exist independently, inherently. Second, nothing exists independently, inherently. Then there's a contradiction. So people got a question. Then he asked question to Buddha, what does it mean? First you said, you know, things are exist independently, inherently. Second you said nothing exists independently, nothing exists inherently. We feel there's a contradiction. Then Buddha said there's no any contradiction. Because then he differentiate between three natures. The first, the nature of other power nature. The second is thoroughly established. No, so second is the inputted nature, impositional nature. Third is thoroughly established. So the people who follow third will of Dharma, we call, you know, the Madhyamaka proponent. So Chitta Mantra proponent or follower of the Chitta Mantra school. So we have a three, three yans, forceful or fifth. Then, the another teaching, not included into the common theory of Dharma, which is the Vajrayana teaching. So Vajrayana has two types. One is the Hindu Vajrayana and Buddhist Vajrayana. If you look, very roughly, you cannot see much differences between Buddhist Vajrayana and Hindu Vajrayana, because when you look at the paintings of the chakras, you can see very similar chakra of the head, then neck, heart, then belly, the secret source, there's 5 or 7 chakra. The chakra is very similar, and also the channels are very similar, and also tumo, the English, what they call tumo, the hip,
inner hip,
the practice of inner hip, controlling the energy, uprise and downrise, everything is very similar. That's why many people ask question to many master, what is the difference between Hindu Vajrayana and Buddhist Vajrayana? The answer said, if your practice not conjoined with the bodhicitta renunciation, then your practice is Hindu Vajrayana. If your practice conjoined with the bodhicitta emptiness, then the Vajrayana is the Buddhist Vajrayana. So it's very similar. That's why, the Theravadas people like Sri Lanka, Thailand, Burma, even though after just Buddha passed away, there were a lot of debate, a lot of controversy between, somebody say the Vajrayana, the Buddhist Vajrayana is not taught by Buddha, it is come from Hindu. Not only that, all Mahayana teaching is not taught by Buddha, it's just somebody create, it's nothing taught, but there's a lot of controversy, a lot of debate. Still, the controversy is still there. So the Vajrayana teaching is included into the second wheel of Dharma, because the content, the object is emptiness. First, the second reason, he became third, because when he, Buddha Shakyamuni, gave a teaching about the Prajaparamita or the Vajrapit, at the same time Buddha gave the Vajrayana teaching in South India, in Dhamnakota, now people named Amarvati. And that time when he gave a Vajrayana teaching, so Buddha himself arose as a deity, arose as a Yamantaka. When he gave a teaching, Yamantaka teaching, the Buddha arose as a Yamantaka. When he gave a Guhasamaja teaching, so Buddha himself manifests as a Guhasamaja. When Buddha gave a Kalachakra teaching, Buddha himself manifests as a Kalachakra. Because the Vajrayana teaching mentioned a lot of things about the union practice, male and female union practice. If he manifests as a Sangha, not comfortable, not good, so Buddha manifests as a deity. So, Vajrayana teaching include into second wheel of Dharma. So we have a forceful, because there are three wheel of Dharma. So within the forceful, right now we are studying the Madhyamaka school. In generally, each school claims themselves they are proponent of Madhyamaka. Their school is the Madhyamaka school. For example, the first two schools, Vaibhashika and Swatantrika school, proponent, they mention themselves, we are the Madhyamaka, our school is the Madhyamaka school. All other school, fall into two extremes. So each school has a different, each school has a unique way of how to award to extend. So generally, four school claim themselves, you know, all school is the Madhyamaka school. We are the proponent of Madhyamaka. According to the, you know, the consequences school, then first tier school as well as the autonomous school also falls into extinct. Someone falls into permanent extinct, someone falls into inhalation extinct. So this is the first school. So when we think about the first school, we need to think, you know, there were four groups of people. Middle of the four group, there's a particular object, just an object. Then they discuss the four groups, you know, the four group, one just there from the eastern side, western side, south, north side. They sit, you know, four different directions. Middle of the group, there are a particular object. They discuss the, how the object exists. How the object exists, how the object is come being into exist. Then within the first school, you know, someone is very ordinary person, not really advanced. The one group is big advanced, other group is more advanced. One group is very, their one is very advanced. So when they discuss about the object, how they exist, then the first school thing, you know, everything, the object exists, you know, kind of inherently, solidly. Then the Chitta Mandala thing, how the object exists, how is made of. Then first school says, you know, the object is origin of the part, you know, particle. The first partless particle is the origin. Due to the partless particle, the things are, you know, come together, then the objects exist. Then the Chitta Mandala said, no, there's not really, you know, partless particle, nothing, you know, made of particles. Because nothing exists from the external side. Everything exists from the, you know, inner side. It's not like a projector. The mind is projector. All phenomena is the project of the projector. So for example, when we watch the movie, we can see, you know, people are talking over there, running over there, actually everything comes from the projector. So whatever we feel, whatever we think, whatever we see around us, everything, you know, projection of our mind, is called man only school. It doesn't mean there's no object. There's an object. The object is very much, let's say the object is manifestation of mind. Manifest as object. If there's no mind, there's nothing. There's no projector, then there's no any, you know, projection on the wall. Right? So mind is like projector. That means nothing exists. Nothing comes from the external thing. Externally, everything comes from your mind. Then next, the Madhyamaka. You know, the Madhyamaka school, they said, no, there's no really, you know, things are manifestation of mind, nothing really projection of mind. There's an object, there's a subject. And the object and subject is totally two different entities. Chitta Mandala school, the object and subject is, you know, arise from one substance. One with a mental imprint. For example, you know, so we have a potential in our mind, when the potential, you know, happen, the potential become two parts. One become object, one become subject. And the object and subject actually come from one potential. Look like seed, you know, one seed divided into two, you know, just one is go out other side, just come in this side. That means everything, you know, all the conditioned phenomena arise from one potential. That's why, for example, right now we are here, everybody just look at the Buddha, different people has a different feeling, different people has a different idea. If you talk together, generally everybody thinks you are talking same. If you talk more precisely, very closely, then individually we have a different thoughts. We don't have a same thoughts about the Buddha statue. Somebody said, oh, the Buddha statue is nice. Somebody said, no, nice. So that's why different people has a different thoughts. Different people has a different perception because different people has a different potential. That's why in Chidamandala talk, very unique one, they call common object and uncommon object. Common object and uncommon object. The uncommon object means when among the friends or groups, the thing is only seen by you, not any other except Buddhas, some other people who has a very powerful mind. In the common person, for I have my own unique things which you cannot see. You cannot see. You have your very own unique things we cannot see. They call unique object and ununique object. So this is a very unique kind of idea from Chidamandala. Next, now we are studying about the Madhyamaka. Madhyamaka or Madhyamaka. M-A-R-K, Mark, right? The Indian we call Mark, like a path or rod. The middle rod or middle path. So, within the Madhyamaka school, there are two sub-schools. What are they? Consequences. The first one is autonomous and consequences. So before we move there, can you tell me the definition of the Madhyamaka school, Madhyamaka proponent? What is the definition of the Madhyamaka proponent? What does mean? The meaning. The meaning, actually meaning. Right?
Can I try?
Yes, please.
Nothing exists on its own, not even particles. Mm-hmm. Mind exists on its own. So there is everything that he says. He did not say how does it exist, he only tells that nothing exists on its own, not even the smallest particles.
Yeah, this cross, very good. Proponent. Particles, right? That means that actually he's saying that the proponent of the middle school itself is the person is proponent of Buddhist, this is including the proponent of Buddhist tenets. That means is that he's a kind of proponent of Buddhist tenets. That means he's talking about the person, right? Proponent is the person who propone things. The non-emptiness. So this means who accept that there's no truly existing phenomena. Right? That means there's nothing really exists truly.
What's the difference between this definition and the
Chittamantra? Oh, Chittamantra school is Chittamantra school said nothing exists from the externally. But the mind exists, truly exists. For example, when you look at the book is not exist truly, but the mind exists truly. Okay? He said nothing,
not
exists,
even the
truly exist.
Not even the mind?
No. They call truly existent. Here, truly existent independent existence, very similar, no, even the particle.
So actually, the higher school, both Chittamatra and Madhyamaka, believe that things don't exist inherently, only the lower school.
No. Chittamatra school believe, you know, the external object is not inherently exist.
Yeah.
The mind is inherently exist.
Because they, in the first school, two are under higher and two
are first two schools are lower school.
Because they exist inherently. The two, they are four schools.
Yeah, yeah.
So they classify the two up, two lower and two upper.
Yeah.
So the two lower, they are both believe that thing exists inherently.
Mm-hmm.
This is the general classification when I read. I
no, no.
Because there are different in two, what they call it two lower school and two higher school.
Okay. So the differentiation between lower and upper school is not based on the inherent exists or not.
Oh.
No. Because the first two school, there's a bit, I think, in general, we have to clarify because generally the people can follow the lower school, their view, when they look at the object, when they think about how things are exist. But the person can follow the first of the two school, but they can be Mahayana practitioner. Okay, Mahayana practitioner. The person practice bodhicitta, but the view is very similar with the first two school. But there are differences. Second, the person, the view, their view is exactly similar with the Madhyamaka view, but they don't practice bodhicitta. But the person is included into Mahayana practitioner. But their tenets, their school is the lower school. Okay, lower school. The one person practice bodhicitta, but their view is very similar with the first two school. But the person included into Mahayana practitioner, the school is the lower school. There's a different shape. Now is Mahayana, we call it, you know, lower and upper, you know, based on, you know, bodhicitta, practice of bodhicitta, not based on the practice, you know, not based on the emptiness, not based on the bodhicitta, based on the teaching. We call Mahayana tenets, proponent, because they follow the Mahayana teaching. Because second wheel of Dharma, third wheel of Dharma is the Mahayana teaching. They follow the Mahayana teaching. They will call Mahayana, upper school, because their teaching is Mahayana. The first one is the lower school, because their teaching is not the Mahayana teaching. This is the Hinayana teaching. Generally, people think, you know, if the person is follow Mahayana school, they think the person must be Mahayana practitioner. It's not true. Okay? The person can be Mahayana practitioner, can be follow the lower school. The person can be the, you know, follow the Mahayana school, but their view is the lower school. Generally, Mahayana upper and lower school, we call, you know, Mahayana and Hinayana tenets is based on the teaching, not based on the practice. But many people have a confusion. They think, you know, if the people follow the Mahayana school, they must be Mahayana practitioner, not truth. Or they think the people follow the Hinayana tenets, they think the people is Hinayana. Okay, it's not true. So Maha or Hina based on the teaching. So since today everybody really try to memorize that and, you know, try to understand the meaning. First we call the Madhyamaka school, mean they follow the middle way. When they say follow the middle way, they have to avoid. They need to avoid two extremes, extreme of permanent, extreme of annihilation. Now I hope you remember last time what I said to you. If you they say you need to avoid two extreme means, even say you must walk in the middle road. And there's two other roads, side by side. The two roads exist, right? Peter said, you must walk in the middle. This means there's another side you should not walk, another side should not walk. There's not two sides there. When I say you must follow the middle way, you must avoid the two extremes. The two extremes are not exist. The permanent, and negation both is non-existent phenomena. The permanent extreme is not same meaning as the permanent and impermanence. Okay? You must avoid the permanent extreme. The meaning of permanent is different than the permanent and impermanence. Okay? Within the permanent impermanence, things are changing momentarily, that we call impermanence. Okay, impermanence. The permanent, we say you must avoid the permanent extreme. It's not talking about between the permanent and impermanence. No. Yeah. Because this permanent meaning is overestimate. That means, for example, things are exist merely designation. Due to some misunderstanding, people think no, things do not exist merely, thoughts and name. They exist inherently. They put external value, external characteristic. They call permanent. Because when they translate into English, we typically call tattha. Tattha. Tha is the extreme, kind of edge or extreme. Ta is permanent. That's why the sound comes very similar, but the meaning is big difference. This means Madhyamaka Suguru, they don't deny everything. They accept everything, but they deny, truly existent phenomena. Nothing exists truly. So, what happened? If things are exist truly exist, what happened? Then there's a problems, right? If things are exist truly, inherently, so what are the problem will be? If there's no problem where they said, they are not truly existent phenomena. That's why I think I said few times last time, when you study about TENET, you really need to forget you are Buddhist, you believe in Buddhism, you totally forget. You really need to be, very honest, You really try to understand how things exist. You should not think, I have to accept this way because I'm Buddhist. I have to accept that because the Buddha said this way. You look like a very new person trying to discover how things are exist. For example, we have 6-7 people here. If we talk about how things exist, so somebody give a different idea. So that's why if you think this way, then you're going to understand how things are exist. According to Madhyamaka Sukul, truly existent phenomena and dependent phenomena is contradiction. Okay? Truly existent phenomena and dependent phenomena is contradiction. If somebody says things exist independently, right? Then indirectly saying nothing exists inherently. If somebody says I'm dependent on someone, that means the person is not independent. I am independent, this means you are saying I am not to rely on anybody. There's much a thing in the symbole. For example, look at the book is stand on the table. It stand on, depend on the table. The table depend on the ground. Without ground, table cannot exist. Without table, the book cannot stand on the stand, book stands. Does it mean? If you think very closely, think very precisely, yeah, all phenomena depend on something. Right? Even though this is ordinary people going to understand, yeah, things that exist depend on something. Yes? Tree depend on, you know, seed. Seed depend on the previous seed, water. This is very gross of meaning of gross dependent origination. Very gross. Even the common people understand. Even the first school know, right? The barley seed depend on the barley depend on the barley seed. The barley seed depend on the previous barley seed. Even the first two school understand. It doesn't mean they understand, you know, the subtle dependent origination. The second one, do you remember? Dependent on causes and condition. Number one, number two, dependent on
parts and whole.
Parts and wholes. Very good. Parts and whole. Then the first two school, they don't understand. You know, things are dependent on parts and whole. The Chitta Mandara Madhyamaka school understand things are exist dependent on parts and whole. Then the last one. What's the last meaning of
imputed.
Subtle dependent origination?
Imputed.
Merely
designation.
No. First one, you know, dependent on causes and condition. Second, dependent on parts and whole. Third one, dependent on name and thoughts. Merely name and thoughts. Again, then Rupa. Yeah, merely name and thoughts. The last one, only the Madhyamaka school, the special, you know, the Chitta, the consequences school, understand, otherwise, not other school. So now you just think, you know, for example, we everybody have our own name. For example, you know, they think this is a table, right? This is a table. So, we everybody just think why it is table. Why it is table? How this thing, I'm not saying how the table, how this thing become a table? How? How this thing become a bed? Before this, you know, put together, things are lived separately. There wasn't table. When we join the whole parts, then somehow this thing, I'm not saying this table, this thing become a table. How? That's been just thing, you know, how this thing become a table, number one. Number two, where's the table? Then the first two school said, okay, they're saying, this is table. This is table. Table is exists from their own side. Not only that, if you try to find the table from the table side, they believe you can find something which is we can say this is table. Also, Chitta Mandara also, you know, everything you can find at their own side. Then, even though the, within the Madhyamaka, the autonomous school, if you try to find, you must find something from the, this side. Otherwise, there's no reason. This is only table. It is not. This is bed, this is table. We must differentiate. Right? But there's something we can differentiate, table and bed. Because this is made of wood, this is also made of wood. Why this is bed? Why this is table? Then, if you think this way, you know, more closely, more deeply, 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 finally, okay, you should know that you are really about to enter into table. When we look at, we think this is very hard, not in your whole. If we think, you know, the in the particular level, right? Particular level. If we think, you look like I can, you know, I can, my hand can go through the table. If we think, if we look at, we cannot. That's why, you know, last time somebody said, the people who realize emptiness, they can go through the wall, they can go through the, you know, in the doors, there's no any contract things. So far, we have a suffering. We have a physical suffering, we have mental suffering. Right? The physical suffering, the physical, you know, the mental suffering, the mental emotion, there are two types, positive and negative. So we can feel it. Some emotional arising within us is make us happy, is make other happy, right? There's another negative, we call negative, you know, the unpleasant emotion, like, you know, anger, attachment, desire. Why we have strong attachment towards something? Today we have very strong, yesterday we had very strong desire, attachment or towards something. Yesterday we thought the thing is very complete, very nice, very beautiful. Somehow this morning or today we think the object is totally ugly. The object yesterday and today, I don't say exactly in the same way, look similar. If you take a photo, if you show the photo to people, you know, if you took a photo yesterday with a beautiful object, beautiful person, same one. Okay? And today, you are asking to take another photo. If you show these two photos to other people, they say, yeah, it's same, exactly same. Same nice or same ugly. When you look at the photo, you can see yesterday photo was so nice, today photo was very ugly. Right? So how we have a, you know, all the confusion, how we have a lot of misunderstanding? Because we don't understand the subtle reality. Subtle reality. That's why I say, you know, ugly, beautiful, ugly, everything just merely depend on your way of thinking, just merely your thoughts. That's what Chitta Mantra said, you know, all phenomena exist merely your name and thoughts. Nothing really, you know, exists from object side. You cannot find anything object side. That's what they call, you know, delusion. Delusion. So somehow, you know, this table exists, even though first two school also accept this is exists, Chitta Mantra school also accept this is exists, this is table, Madhyamaka also said this is table. But they say this table, but the thought is a bit different, right? First two school say this is table, they think the table is there, exists from the table side. Chitta Mantra Sukhruji, this is table. According to Chidam Mantra Subha, this table is looked like, you know, the look like dream. Oh, dream. The dream is not separate than the mind. The mind is not separate than the dream. We are not saying dream is mind, mind is dream. The dream is just a reflection of the mind. Right? That means the table is kind of just manifestation of your individual mind. They said Chidam Mantra Subha said this is table. According to Chidam Mantra Subha, this table looks like dream table. At the moment when you have a dream about table, this moment you think, oh, you have a beautiful, you know, table. When you awake, if you reflect the table, just you have a memory, nothing there. Then next, the Madhyamaka school, you know, is the higher school, say, yeah, no, the table don't look like exactly a dream. This table is true, this table is there. This is table, is eyes consciousness. Eyes consciousness perceive the table. This is table. But the table is primarily, you know, designated by thoughts and name. So due to the, you know, lack of understanding of the subtle reality, then we have a ignorance, based on ignorance, there's attachment, based on attachment, they are hated. Without attachment or desire, we cannot have a hatred. Right? I gave you example last time. So I get the mala example. The mala is very simple, you know, mala. Somebody explained this is very expensive. One piece of mala costs maybe $100. Then you really think, wow, it's very expensive. And suddenly you got very strong attachment. And somebody give this mala, you feel so happy. Because you have a misunderstanding. And if you lose, then you get very upset. All the upset, all the lacking, sense of lack, everything comes based on the ignorance. If you know this mala is very simple mala, if somebody says this is so expensive, it is so beautiful, you really don't care, right? Because you know the reality. So you don't know the reality, that's why we have a misperception, misunderstanding. We got negative attachment, whatever negative call, you know, we call negative or maybe bad thoughts. Everything arises based on misperception, misunderstanding, ignorance. The ignorance here, you should not think, you know, the mind which is not nothing. Ignorance. The wisdom thing perceive merely designation. Ignorant perceive things are exist inherently. It's opposite. But in the first two school, in the definition of ignorance, and the second two school, the definition of ignorance is a bit different. Ignorance. So nothing exists inherently, even though particle. Existing phenomena, not even particles. As a particle is talking more in criticizing of two, the first two schools. Then we have two sub-schools. What are they? Problem of medial autonomies and proponent of medial consequences school. The second is a autonomous school. It has a four parts, right? Definition, etymology, sub-schools. Can you tell me the definition of autonomous school? The definition of unautonomous is a proponent of non-entityness who accept the phenomena exist by their own character conventionally, although not ultimately. So this is the definition of autonomous school. That means exists by their own character conventionally, not, although not ultimately. So here again, generally conventional truth and ultimate truth, right? We have two truths, conventional and ultimate truth. What does mean conventional truth? What does mean ultimate truth? In Tibetan languages, you know, what is it, the meaning? We call kunzok demba. But conventional, there's a two parts, conventional truth, ultimate and truth. Conventional, conventional here referred to the particular mind. This table is truth based on the conventional mind. Okay, emptiness of this table is truth based on the ultimate mind. This means, you know, all the arhat minds are ultimate mind. Non-arya, the people who not reach to the seeing path, you know, the very ordinary being, minds are conventional mind. Arya mind is the ultimate mind. That means, you know, everything, but this is really truth for us. That is truth for us, is true for us, but is totally false for the Arya. Emptiness is, for us, is totally false. We don't understand. We don't really accept. But it is really true for the Arya. That's why Buddha said, you know, very, very tiny, like a small piece of hair in my hand, ordinary person cannot see it. Because it's too small, you know, too tiny, ordinary person cannot see it. That's when the ultimate, the emptiness is so subtle, that's why ordinary person cannot understand, cannot see it. That's why this ultimate truth is not the truth for the conventional people, because they don't understand. That's, you know, that's why first, you know, we say true truth, conventional truth, ultimate truth is a two parts, conventional, convention, and truth, ultimate and truth. So it's so interesting to think this way. What the, you know, Kundalini just said. The more you think, the more think about the conventional things, you will have a very strong conviction about your law of causality. Okay? The more you think about the conventional truth, the more you have a conviction about law of causality. Think. Then the more you think about ultimate or emptiness, the more you have a conviction about the conventional truth. That's why we should not have a bias between conventional truth and ultimate truth. That plus I said to you, we should not make a bias between ultimate truth and conventional truth. We must look equally. Without conventional truth, there's no ultimate truth. Without ultimate truth, there is no conventional truth. First one is very easy, right? Without conventional truth, there is no ultimate truth. Why? Very simple, say, no table, no emptiness of table. Very easy. Right? No basis, no characteristic. no conditional truth, no ultimate truth. It's very easy. The second, if there's no ultimate truth, why no conditional truth exists? Why? Give me answer. Yes? There's no conventional truth. There's no ultimate truth. Because ultimate truth is the characteristic of the conventional truth. Very easy. Right? That's why no table, no emptiness of table. Because emptiness of the table is the characteristic of table. Easy, right? The second, if there is no ultimate truth, why not conventional truth?
Because then there's no emptiness
until
there's no
negation. That's why, you know, in the Harsudara, form is emptiness. Very easy to understand. The form is emptiness because if you try to find the form from the form side, you cannot find. The nature of the form is totally empty of inherent existence. The second, emptiness is form. It's directly in the word saying emptiness is form. But emptiness is not form. Emptiness is permanent. Form is impermanent. Impermanent. Permanent cannot be with permanent. As a permanent cannot be impermanence. Then look at form is emptiness. You know, form nothing. The form is not exist from the form side. Their nature is total emptiness. Nature is emptiness. Emptiness is form. That means, you know, when you think the form, you must recognize the form, the nature is emptiness. Without the empty of the nature, you cannot, you know, find the form. Form. First reason. Second reason, look at, things are dependent, that's why there's a suffering, there's a happiness. The happiness, suffering come from where? Origin. The suffering is dependent on the cause and condition. There's a cause and condition of suffering, that's why there's a suffering, right? If there is no causes condition of suffering, there cannot be suffering. Right? That means the suffering, the happiness is dependent on causes condition. It depends on causes condition, that's why the nature of the suffering, the nature of the happiness is inherently empty of inherent existence, empty of independent existence. So last time I asked you, I think you get the copy. So last time I asked you to find out the 18 emptiness. You gave me a copy, right? You, where's the copy? 18 emptiness, 4 emptiness, don't need to, okay. But there are, you know, different 18 types of emptiness. For all 18 emptiness including the 4. 4 emptiness including the first truth, 2 truths. You should not think that 18 different emptiness are different based on the negation. No. Different because of the basis. Emptiness of the external. Emptiness of the internal phenomena. Emptiness of the both. Emptiness of the great. Emptiness of the small. But the next time you make a bring a copy and give a copy for everybody. Okay. So we have a 18 emptiness and 4 emptiness. Because it's related to here, right? So related to the autonomous school. Okay, definition. So how many sub-school in the autonomous school? It has a two sub-school, right? There are two division. Yogic autonomy medium-based school and Sutra autonomy medium-based school. It's very simple. I think, you know, within the autonomy school, someone, their view is very close to the first two school. Someone view is very close to the Chittamantra school. That is a yogic Chittamantra. Sutra, you know, autonomous. Yogi autonomy medium-based school, Sutra autonomy medium-based school. So before we explain the sub-school, do you remember what does mean autonomy school? Autonomy. Autonomy region, right?
Yeah.
It's similar meaning, autonomy school. Look at it. Why are they called proponent of middle way autonomous school? They are called such as because they refute truly existing thing through relying on a correct logical sign. So three aspects exist from their own side. Do you understand the meaning? Why are they called proponent of middle-based autonomous school? They are called such as because they refute. Refute means deny, right? Deny or refute. Refute what? Refute truly existent thing. How they refute truly existent thing? Through relying on a correct logical sign, right? This means, you know, autonomous or consequences of both refute truly existing phenomena. But this school refuse truly existing thing, how they refute? Refute through the rely on correct logical sign. So also ask, what are the three aspects? Three aspects exist from their own side. Three aspects. So now do you remember three aspects?
No.
Last I asked you to.
Yes.
Right? Yes. When we have a class, we get to
Subject, reason.
Subject.
Reason. Predicate.
Very good.
No,
very good.
My notes. Reason, subject, reason, and
okay,
reason.
Subject. For example, let's say, okay, that's very easy. Maybe you can say, usually we say sprout, nucuchogens. Sprout is the subject. Okay, for example, the table is subject. Table is subject because this is the basis of argument. Okay, subject. Basis of argument. So somebody said this table is truly exist. Some school said this table is not truly exist. That means the table is subject or argument of the basis of argument is subject. Then this table is not, you know, truly existent. Not truly existent is one aspect. You remember? I think when Geshela have a class, I think he explained very well. I don't try to remember. Basis. Okay, anyway, so next time when we have a class, everybody, that's me, you know, this table is refute to the existent. Refute, rely on what? Logical sign. Refuse rely on logic. Okay. Then when autonomists say, you know, the logics, the three aspects exist from their own side. Less easy way, you know, if somebody shoot a bullet, they kill someone. Killed. And the bullet is exists from their own. That's why the bullet can kill the person. Chidamantara said, you know, the three aspects exist from their own side. Otherwise, the three aspects cannot refute truly existing phenomena. We cannot refuse, you know, simply, you know, things not exist inherently. But we have to rely on logic. The logic has a three aspects. For example, the supraord is the basis. Not exist inherently, not truly existent, is the one aspect. The reason is dependent origination. He said, you know, the support is not truly existent because it is dependent origination. The dependent origination is the reasoning. I think basis, reasoning, and predicate, right? So three aspects. So autonomists, you know, they refuse truly existent. Rely on the logic. The logic has a three aspect. The three aspect exist from their own side. That's why they are called autonomous. So it's a two sub school. Yogic autonomy middle way school. Sutra autonomy middle way school. That meaning within the autonomies, someone's view is close to the Chitta Mantra, that we call yogi autonomy. It's nothing to do with the yogi and yoga. Yogi and yoga is Chitta Mantra. Second is, their view is very close to whom? Close to the Sutra school. That's what I call Sutra, you know, autonomy, middle way school. Najarjabhasas. Now you can see the reason why they name, you know, yogic autonomy, Sutra autonomy. The definition of proponent of the yogic autonomy, middle way school is, okay, is a proponent of the middle way school who accepts self-cognizing consciousness and does not exist external object. That means they don't accept the external object, but still accept self-cognizing consciousness. Because they does not accept external object. Because Chitta Mandala school is the first school who, you know, refute the external object, right? That's why their view is close to the Chitta Mandala school, because they refute external object. That's why their view is close to Chitta Mandala. Okay. So self-cognizer also is very important kind of, I think, topic. First two school, accept self-cognizer externally existent. Chitta Mantra school Chintamandala school, I think, refuse the self-cognizer, a thing we check, I mean double check. Self-cognizer is very important topic. That's why, for example, very interesting, huh? Madhyamaka school proponent says, this is table. This table exists, we can prove by eyes consciousness. When the eyes see table, yeah, this table is can be, is exists proved by eyes consciousness. The second, sir, how you can prove you have a eye consciousness? Then others will say there's another consciousness which is cognized by eye consciousness. Table recognized by eyes consciousness, eyes consciousness recorded by the self-cognizer. Why they call self-cognizer? Because, okay, table is exists proved by eyes consciousness. Eyes consciousness exists proved by the there's another mind because self-cognizer. The self-cognizer cognizes eyes consciousness as itself, self-cognizer. You know that first table, second eye consciousness, behind eye consciousness, there's another mind. The another mind cognizes eye consciousness. So who cognizes the another mind? There's no need. It itself can cognize. It's a double kind of, you know, object. One himself, it itself cognizes, is also cognized the eye consciousness. And Madhyamaka school said very interesting there. Can you see the table? Yes, that's maybe your eye consciousness. You don't need any another thing can prove. If you're able to see the table, that means you have a eye consciousness. This is the proof, you have eye consciousness. You don't need to rely on other consciousness. Simple way. The self-cognizer. So they refuse the, you know, truly refute truly existent thing through the rely on a correct logical sign with three aspects exist from their own side. This is the main meaning of the autonomies. Okay, autonomous mean, you know, kind of independent, you know, the three aspect is exist from their own side. That means autonomy, independent kind of things. Next, the definition. Second is also, you know, refuse. Sorry, the definition of proponent of Yogacita Savaja. The definition of proponent of Sutra Autonomy Middle Way School is proponent of the Middle Way School who does not accept, now he refutes the self cognizer, thy consciousness, but external object existence is totally opposite. First, you know, they claim, they assert self-cognizer. Second, they don't accept a self-cognizer. Does not assert self-cognizing consciousness, and who accept the external object exists by way of their own character. It's totally opposite, right? First, you know, accept the self-cognizing consciousness, but do not accept the external object. Second is totally refuse the self-cognizing consciousness, but they accept the external object exists, not only exists by way of their own character.
What do you mean by
that? That's mean, let's, okay, this is a good question, you know. For example, in generally, in the ordinary people's thing, the fire is hot, very hot. Why fire is hot? Water is cool. Yes. You can say nature. They say water is hot by their own sight. We're hot by their own. It's not some not somebody, you know,
yes.
Or somebody really made as a hot. It's very simple. We say it's hot because there is hot by their own. It's a nature.
Isn't this the same as the lower school?
Huh?
So does it make it similar to the lower school?
Yes. That's why within the autonomies, you know, sutra autonomy is very close to the first school. Yogic autonomy middle school is very close to the chitta mantra school. They were called yogic chitta autonomy. Sutra autonomy. Yogic chitta mantra autonomy. You can say chitta mantra autonomy middle way. Sutra autonomy middle way.
What's the difference?
Hmm?
What's the difference with the lower schools?
Because both of them refuse truly existent phenomena. Right? Yogic autonomy or sutra autonomy, both they refute truly existent things. First two school, chitta mantra, they refute, don't refute, they accept truly existent phenomena.
That means last time the scholars went, yes, I'm debating all this.
Right.
I mean, now I start thinking, I mean, all in discussion. You bring your own school, or somehow everybody had their own way of thinking, then it was summarized.
Uh-huh.
It made us really.
Okay, first thing was, I think something.
This Madhyamaka is the highest view, right?
Madhyamaka view is the higher views, yeah.
No.
Within the Madhyamakas, there's a true autonomous and subsequent school. Within the true, the subsequent is the highest view.
Consequence of the Madhyamaka, Yogacara.
Yeah.
And the other one is?
Huh?
Sometimes you cut it.
No. Pasangika, consequences.
Insan-tong-wan.
Yeah.
In Chinese, how insan-tong-wan?
Chinese?
Song-wan is Madhyamaka.
In Chinese, right?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Can you understand Chinese?
No.
Okay, Rinpoche, sorry to distract you. I know you are having this Dharma talk, but my brother here got some health problem. Can you bless him or your health? He want to become a Buddhist monk, but then he got this health sickness. I let him talk to you as well. Later, if you can give time, you will have a consultation and will you help him bless him or mention Buddha?
Okay, I'm not sure. Okay, so anyway, we have a, you know, this after class, maybe I can talk a little bit. So we have a true sub-school, yogi autonomy and sutra autonomy. Now you know the meaning. Okay. So within the, I think, the definition then, the illustration is, okay, not easy, huh? Look at, so we have a true sub-school. Within the top sub-school, there's a yogi and the sutra autonomies. The illustration is the master Shandirakhita, who is considered to be the founder of this sub-school. This refers to what? Sutra, middle way, Sutra autonomous middle way school. Illustration is the master Shandirakhita, who considered to be the founder of this school, that is Yogi Autonomy School. So Shandirakhita included into the yogi autonomous, because he was the founder of the yogi autonomous middle school. The definition of proponent of Sutra autonomous middle school is proponent middle who does not accept cognizance consciousness, who accept the external object exists by way of their own character. Illustration is Master Bhavavika, who is considered to be the founder of the autonomous school, founder of the autonomous school and own of this sub school. Okay, so Shandira is the founder of the yogi autonomous school. Bhavavika is founder of the autonomous school as well as Sutara autonomous school. Because, you know, when we think, you know, the difference between two of them look very easy. I don't think it's very easy because Bhavavika, Shandirakita, they are very famous, very scholar, very practitioner. Even though, you know, one of the Shandirakita, you know, don't accept external object, but accept self-cognizing. Then Bhavavika don't accept self-cognized consciousness, but accept external object exist by way of their own character. It is not easy. It's not easy. Not easy, even though, you know, they are very high practitioner, very scholar, very master, still not easy to accept things are, you know, exist externally. Nothing exists externally. It's not easy.
But do they have any written examples to show this?
This is, I think, that's what I said to you just before. When we think in the, you know, subatomic level, in this table, we can think my hand can go through a table. When we think, when we look at, we know my hand cannot go through a table. It's attached, it's blocked, right? So both of them is not just. There's not just, we can call, you know, the in the mental level or reasoning level, if you think that the reasoning only one side, then think, yes, it's not impossible to things that exist externally, one reason. If you think another way, then you must think things that exist externally. For example, you know, when you push a wall, you know, you pushing the wall, you know, you it hurt you, that wall hurt you, right? Hurt you. That means the wall is exist externally. Right? That means the thing is there. Both of saying, this is table, the table is there. There's no, you know, argument. This is table is there. But the table is there, but is the table is from external side or internal side? This is the argument. There's no argument about the table. They don't have an argument about in the table is exists or not. They are arguing about the, how the table exists from the external side or not. There's one school says yes, it exists from externally. Not externally, but exists their own way. I mean, you know, this exists from their side. That's other school says no. Not really exists externally. That means again go into the similar with the Chitta Mantra, you know, manifest of the mind. Also, you know, if we really think at the subatomic levels, we say, you know, the world is exists from the world side. If you use the very strong microscope. Oh, you cannot see the wall. Right? You cannot see the wall. Just full of kind of particles is moving around. That moment, if you just use the, you know, the middle school, middle school, you really feel I can go through the wall.
But Geshela, Buddha time there's no microscope. So how does the scholar come up with this logic? Sorry, a very simple one. I'm really thinking because they don't have those equipment. So how did they think? How did they see the wall in particles?
Because, you know, if you really think how things are exist, be honest, if you really think how things exist, then you think again, then you really think, you know, there's a wall, the wall is made of brick and what? Brick and mud or cement. Just take one brick, think about the brick. Within the brick, there's a millions of particles, right? If you just pick up one particle, thinking about the one particle, also you think within the one particle, there's so many sub-particles. So that's why they don't use the microscope. They use their mind, set the wall, break into parts. Within the part, you go this way. It looks like they're using the microscope. They're using their own mind. Okay, so we can stop here. It's quite, we see have a few time, but I think we're going to try it. So next time when you come back, 18 emptiness, 4 emptiness, then the three aspect. Okay, 3 homeworks. 18 emptiness, 4 emptiness, 3 aspect. If you really want to know the 3 aspect is very detailedly, there's a book, I think, Tibetan, written by, given by Lady Rinpoche. Tibetan mind and mental factor, right? Tibetan mind and mental factor, something. We have a book in the library, but.
Inside Tibetan mind.
Huh?
Inside Tibetan mind.
Inside Tibetan mind, but you can see there's a picture of monks who are holding the drum.
I will share.
Yeah.
I have the book.
Okay, so you want to see something?
No, I mean, there are so many schools. Are they in reality currently, they are still not practicing different, they call themselves true followers? Or this is really a so-called, like a philosophy or this? Do you have currently practitioners who claim they are followers of their school or this school?
Yeah.
What about you? You are a follower.
I follow.
We have
many in my monastery, in the Dipu monastery, someone totally stick in the one school. They totally reject. Even though I think nowadays one of the in seven monastery there's a one Sus monk. Right now he's a disco. He just follow the Chidamanda school. Yes, sir, we have many master. Master said, I just only follow the Madhyamaka school.
Because now they are studying all this. So finally,
did you have really... For me, I personally really happy with the autonomous school. Because autonomous school is very easy to understand us. He said, little bit from your mind side, your side, little bit from object side, is the combination. Something there, there's something there. Then we give a name. It's come on 2 things, object and subject. If you say nothing exists from the object side, there's something nowhere, nothing there. I personally am more, the autonomous school is my favorite.
Geshela, in a way you are saying that we are so used to there must be something and we add on something to it. So if there is no particles, there is nothing for you to impute on. That's which is why the autonomous schools is more resonant to most of the people. Because if you were to say that Chitta Mantra, everything is in mind, that means there's nothing there. So when you are hit, you will not feel pain, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
Is it something along that line? And Geshela, come back to Su Hong's questions, right? She said she was asking, is there a people really call themselves what school or whichever school? From my very little understandings about Chinese Mahayana, it is not call yourself what school you are, it's what sutra or what basis that you are propounding. So like in Chinese Mahayana, most of the items that it always point out to everything are the creations of the mind. So when they try to explain things, and the resolutions always fall back to everything is the creations of mind. So in that, you are, by definitions of the category, you are mind-only school. But it doesn't mean that I have a school that have a label in the door says mind-only school, then you enter,
yeah,
then you belong to that.
It's just people who, now we are studying all the to understand better, so somehow, after years, what inclination? I mean, currently, it's still a situation.
And you surround myself, right, because most of the Chinese master in the past, they follow the Chittamanda school. Because they always mention 8 minds. The people who talks about 8 minds, you just talk, okay, if they believe in the 8 minds, they 100% follow the Chittamanda school. Chittamanda school is the only school who talk about the 8 minds. Look at when you read the text written by Chinese master, they always talk, you know, everything is a reflection of your mind. When your mind becomes very calm, everything becomes calm. Because everything is, you know, arising from your mind. Chittamanda Sukha says, same thing, mind is the root of the origin, everything arises from your mind. Then, one of the Tibetan masters said, you know, usually Chittamanda Sukha can say everything is a mind. But other masters say it's a bit uncomfortable to say everything is a mind. It just look like mind. Yeah. That's why I think most of the Chinese, you know, masters follow the Chittamanda school, but I think among the Chinese masters, there are so many masters who follow the Nagarjuna school. Right? Nagarjuna school. Honsu Busa. Okay, so we can stop here. So thank you so much. So next time, we don't forget our 3 homework. 18, emptiness, 4 emptiness, and 3 aspects. Okay, so we do the dedication prayers.